I am Professor Indrani Mukherjee from the Department of English, University of Allahabad. The topic of today's module is Voices from China, Japan and Russia. Now, I would like to speak on women's liberation, Japanese feminism and gender relationships. South Asia is an area of the world containing remarkable ethnic, linguistic, religious, geographical and political diversity. This cultural variety makes South Asia a fascinating topic of study. Recent scholarship on women in South Asia has analyzed the manner in which class, religion and colonial political and economic structures have influenced the condition of women. There has also been an effort to understand how South Asian women themselves view their options and positions. By the time the nascent elite feminist movement had begun to pulsate at the turn of the century, China had suffered a series of humiliating military and territorial defeats at the hands of the imperialistic powers of Western Europe, Russia and Japan, and the demand for concessions related to women seemed to continue unabated. Voices from the Far East arose mainly from China, Japan and Russia. The Chinese women constitute one of the greatest masses of disinherited human beings the world has ever seen. The communist revolution paved the way for the increasingly active women's rights groups in China. Prior to the 20th century, women in China were considered essentially different from men. Li Xiaojiang is often credited as the founder of women's studies in China. Her 1983 essay, Progress of Mankind and Women's Liberation, was the first women's studies publication in China. The Association of Women's Studies was founded 2 years later. Another early 20th century prominent feminist was the anarchist He Yinzhen, who founded the journal Natural Justice. Another early 20th century prominent feminist was the anarchist He Yinzhen, who founded the journal Natural Justice while in exile in Japan. Yu Zhengzi and Yuan Mi were two of the first male feminists in China. Feminism in Japan began in the late 19th century and early 20th centuries. Before the 19th century, Japanese women were traditionally taught to obey a male, a father, husband, brother or son. The topic of Japanese feminism is just as sprawling, complicated, diverse and self-contradictory as American feminism. After the Meiji Restoration abolished the feudal system, changes were made in the status of women. The topic of Japanese feminism is just as sprawling, complicated, diverse and self-contradictory as American feminism. The Russian women had a difficult time articulating a voice in literature until as recently as the 1980s. Having found this new voice, many women writers have countered the widespread gender assumptions inherent in patriarchal Russian culture. Several contemporary Russian women authors like Lyudmila Petrushevskaya, Nina Sadur, Tatiana Tolstoya and Lyudmila Ulitskaya have challenged binary gender stereotypes, particularly women-specific ones. Each author has uniquely rejected a prescribed definition of woman in her writing, and together the four authors present an organized, coherent literary rebellion against conventional notions of femininity. Now, we come to Voices from China, and I would like to give an overview. The beginning of the century marked a period of growing unrest for women as the feminist movement took hold. In the 1920s and 1930s, Freudian psychoanalysis gained favor with Chinese feminists looking to study gender relationships. Lisa Tuttle has refined feminist theory as asking new questions of old texts. She cites the goals of feminist criticism as developing and uncovering a female tradition of writing, interpreting symbolism of women's writing so that it will not be lost or ignored by the male point of view, rediscovering old texts, analyzing women writers and their writings from a female perspective, resisting sexism in literature, and increasing awareness of the sexual politics of language and style. Qiu Jin was a Chinese writer and poet, a strong-willed feminist who is considered a national hero in China. Also called Jian Hu Nuxia, Woman Knight of Mirror Lake, she was executed after participating in a failed uprising against the Qing dynasty. She wrote about female heroes and warriors from Chinese history in inspiring poems about their strength, courage, and beauty. One of her poems begins, "Don't tell me women are not the stuff of heroes." She used her poetry with literary allusion to heroines of the past to express her concern about the fate of China and Chinese women. To this day, Qiu Jin is a symbol of women's independence in China. He Xin was an early 20th century Chinese feminist and anarchist. She was a male theorist as well as the editor of a prominent feminist anarchist journal, Natural Justice. She took the name He Xin, but signed her published writings He Yin Zhen in order to include her mother's maiden name. She published a number of strong attacks in anarchist journals on male social power, which argued that society could not be free without the liberation of women. Unlike her contemporaries, He Zhen was less concerned with China's fate as a nation and more with the relationships between patriarchy, imperialism, capitalism, and gender subjugation. He Zhen was less concerned with China's fate as a nation and more with the relationships between patriarchy, imperialism, capitalism, and gender subjugation as global and trans-historical problems. Her bold writings were considered radical and dangerous in her lifetime and gradually have been erased from the historical record. The essay traces the exploitation of women's labor from the times immemorial, especially condemning the tragedies of prostitution, female infanticide, and concubinage of recent time. Economic revolution and women's revolution, and On the Revenge of Women, are two works that take up the question of men as the arch enemy of womankind. On feminist anti-militarism and the Feminist Manifesto are also powerful indictments of male social power. Next we come to Ding Ling. Ding Ling is one of the most celebrated 20th century Chinese women writers as well as an influential communist revolutionary figure. Unfortunately, as a result of the hectic societal changes in China during the former half of the 20th century, her writings got eclipsed by her personal life. When she was in her 20s, she flung herself passionately into her stories, exploring the female mind and mentality through different female protagonists in urban settings. She is well known for her significant work, Miss Sophia's Diary. With Sophia, Ding Ling explores the realm of moral virtue bestowed upon women and challenges the notion that these ethical virtues arise from the female body's natural disposition to be chaste. It gives a very realistic insight into the modern struggle and crisis of identity from a female point of view. Professor of Zhejiang University, Li Xiaojiang, is considered to be a pioneer of women's and gender studies in the People's Republic of China. She is most well known for her writing, The Progress of Humanity and Women's Liberation. Her efforts led to the creation of the first women's studies classes and the first women's studies department in 1985. In her writing, she advocates for a kind of market feminism in which women express their agency and subjectivity through consumption, particularly of domestic goods and services. For her, the erasure of gender expression during the height of socialist China led to a denaturalization and masculinization of women's studies. For her, the erasure of gender expression during the height of socialist China led to a denaturalization and masculinization of women's bodies. Li has argued that by participating in the new consumer economy, women can recover a sense of their feminine selves as distinct and different from men. Unlike the West, Japan does not have a history of strong feminist movements. Even today, most feminist dialogue takes place within community or civil rights organizations, not feminist activist groups. Raiko Hiratsuka is one of the prominent women writers that we are going to talk about. As a leading light of the women's movement in the early 20th century Japan, Raiko Hiratsuka was a highly influential figure. She also founded the New Women's Association, besides spearheading the first attempt to win women's right to vote in Japan. Her works include her autobiographical novel, In the Beginning, Woman Was the Sun, and The View from the Round Window, as well as The Road I Walked. She proclaimed that the new woman could no longer bear to walk submissively along the road of the old-fashioned women who had been a victim of tyranny, as now it was time to restore the hidden glory of the sun. Fumiko Enchi is another prominent Japanese writer. She succeeded in describing the modern real woman in her works as she delved into the dynamics of gender in modern society. She demolished the myth of the perfect female body to which women are being subjected to. She raised issues related to corporeality that have not been previously dealt with within the Japanese literary tradition. She raised issues related to corporeality that have not been previously dealt with within the Japanese literary tradition. Unconventional motives like the abjection of the maternal body figure in her works such as Masks and Black God, and the repressed female sexuality in works such as Earrings and Enchantress are prominent. Tsushima Yuko is a prolific author and the recipient of numerous literary awards. She has attracted the critical attention of both Japanese and non-Japanese critics. Her texts overwhelmingly focus on areas which appear to be of concern primarily to women, with narratives revolving around issues such as pregnancy and motherhood. We find in Tsushima's work a plethora of single mothers, fatherless children, women estranged from their parents and friends, and alienated from their immediate social environment in general. Her works include the 8 powerful stories of the Shooting Gallery, Child of Fortune, and Woman Running in the Mountains. Kirina Natsuo is another writer who presents a female perspective on serious issues such as prostitution, marriage, and equal employment laws in her novels, which are often based on sensationalist news stories. Her novels mostly center upon women and crime. She is also committed to giving women recognition in Japanese literature, where they are often resigned to sexual and domestic roles. Kirino's novels, Real World and Grotesque, tell sensationalist news stories from the perspectives of the women involved, thus linking crimes committed against women and by women to social misogyny. As regards Russian feminist writing, we can say that feminism in Russia originated in the 18th century, influenced by the Western European Enlightenment and mostly confined to the aristocracy. After the February Revolution, feminist lobbying gained suffrage and nominal equality for women in education and the workplace. Throughout the 19th century, feminism was closely tied to revolutionary politics and social reform. After the fall of the Soviet Union, feminist circles arose amongst the intelligentsia, though the term continues to carry negative connotations among contemporary Russians. Olga Shapir was among those who tried to incorporate both feminism and radicalism in her life and work. Shapir's feminism evolved in the early 1890s and it gave her fiction a new focus and direction. her literary work blended women's concerns with populism. She joined the Russian Women's Philanthropic Society in the 1890s and was a member of the committee of the 1908 Women's Congress. Her novel, The Stormy Years, shows a brave attempt to combine an analysis of revolutionary politics with a critical overview of sexual possibilities. Anastasia Verbitskaya was a well-known Russian novelist, playwright, screenplay writer, publisher, and feminist. Her works include Discord and The Yoke of Love. One of the most sensationally popular and influential of all pre-revolutionary novels, Keys to Happiness, is set against a panorama of Russian society on the eve of the First World War. It tells the stormy tale of Maria Yeltsova, a Russian new woman who pursues her dreams and passions as a dancer and free spirit who captivates, among others, a Jewish socialist tycoon and a reactionary Russian nobleman. At the time of its publication, the novel crossed the boundaries of both gender and class to define a new type of literature in Russian society. Alexandra Kollontai is another very well-known Russian writer. As a Russian revolutionary, she is best known for her organizational work among Russian working class women prior to and immediately after the 1917 revolution. Kollontai did see her special mission as fighting for the interests of working class women. However, when she wrote some of her best pieces concerning women's oppression during the 1920s, like Communism and the Family, Sexual Relations and Class Struggle, Kollontai had retreated from political involvement and struggle within the Russian Communist Party. Being a feminist, she exalts women. She tells women that they are capable of a new freedom, beautiful and unexampled. As a champion of her sex, she appeals to the women of Russia to cast off their chains and not be slaves to religion, marriage or children. Kollontai's letters to working youth prophesied a new kind of relationship between men and women. Maria Arbatova is the author of 14 plays staged in Russia and abroad, 20 books and numerous articles in newspapers and periodicals. Coming from the first woman writer with an open feminist ideology, her books and plays won the hearts of a wide audience immediately. An Equation with Two Knowns, a short story consisting mainly of a dialogue between two characters, he and she, represents the modern Russian situation. Her novel, How I Tried to Get into the Duma Honestly, mocked political corruption. In 2007, she drew international attention when she proposed that since Russian men were drinking and smoking themselves to death, the government should import Indian men for Russian women to marry. In conclusion, it may be said that it is almost a cliche to say that the gauge of the civilization of a country is the manner in which it deals with women. For a very long time, it has been taken for granted that man is superior to woman. After years of subjugation and silencing, this prejudice is gradually giving way to a setup in which she is recognized by man as his equal. The same is true of China, Japan, and Russia. Through significant social activist movements, political measures, and economic reforms, the voices of women are now being heard the world over, notwithstanding the subtle differences in power and status that still exist. Thank you.